So the next chapter we're going to do is chapter 9. So if you bought the textbook starts in chapter 10. So chapter 9 is not in your copy of the textbook. However, I'm pretty sure on Canvas I have the other version of the textbook, the first 9 chapters. So just for one chapter, I don't recommend you go and buy the Precalculus 1 textbook for just this one chapter. So I'll make sure, if this is chapter 9, is not already up on Canvas, I'll make sure I post it up there for this material. So we're going to do 9.1, which is sequences. So we'll start with a definition for sequence. So if you had to define sequence in English, how would you describe a sequence?
Pattern.
So pattern. Sounds pretty good. What about sequential? That means sequence-like. What does that mean? Do they not have vocabulary tests anymore? No. All right, so it usually means one thing after the other, right? A sequence of unfortunate events. It's one bad thing happening after another bad thing after another bad thing. All right, so in math, it's very similar. It's an ordered list of things. In this case, we're going to look at ordered list of numbers. We're going to keep it real, so this will be an ordered list of real numbers. And of course, we can be lazy and write R like that. So it's an ordered list of real numbers. I won't give you complex value sequences, so these will just be real number sequences. The way that we're going to, the notation we're going to use, we use these weird curly brackets. We're usually going to start at 0 or 1. You can start at any number you want. We're going to go up to some big number. I'll put M right there. So what this means is A1, and then A2, and then A3, all the way up to AM. So it's just numbers in order, and we just put commas so we know it's the first number, second number, third number. All right, this is what we call a finite sequence. There's M things. This is a finite sequence. So there's, of course, an infinite sequence. So an infinite sequence is going to look similar. You just have, instead of M, you just write infinity. So it's even easier to write this down. Difficult to think about, easy to write down. You just write dot, dot, dot at the end with no last term. So it should be pretty clear the pattern. And this, of course, infinite sequence. So in general, we could summarize both of these . So we got some initial value for n, and then we have our final value up top. And of course, if you see infinity there, that means there is no last value. You just keep going forever. This initial value usually will be 0 or 1. Those are the two numbers that you most commonly start at. Sometimes we'll start at different numbers, but usually we'll try to start at 0 or 1. All right, easy first question. So write out the terms of this sequence here. So I'll write out the first two terms. So the first term will be negative 1 to the first times 1 over 1. The second term, negative 1 squared times 1 over 2. So write out the last two terms of this sequence. So this is the n equals 1 term, n equals 2 term. I want to know the 3 and the 4 term. So write the 3 and the 4 term and then reduce them on the next line. So any questions about these four terms up here? So one thing that I want you to notice here, what did this negative 1 to the end, what purpose did that serve? What effect did that have? So it makes some terms negative and some terms positive. So it does what we call alternates the sign, S-I-G-N, not S-I-N. So this negative 1 to the n so this alternates the sign. There's another way to alternate the sign. You could do it with a few different trig functions, or you can do it with any periodic function, really, but cosine is the one that you most commonly will see. All right, think about cosine of n times pi. What is cosine of 0? What is cosine of 0? 1. What's cosine of pi? Negative 1. Cos 2 pi? That's positive 1. So you're basically looking at the left and right side of the unit circle, just going back and forth. So here's a tricky way to make things alternate. You can do the same thing in a sine function. You have to be a little careful. It's not quite n pi, but you have to start at pi over 2. And then you can do half rotations. So pi over 2 puts you at the top of the circle. And you go top, bottom, top, bottom, top, bottom, back and forth. All right, so those are some ways that you can alternate signs. So that first example we looked at is way too easy to ever put on a quiz or a midterm. Doesn't take much brain power to do this. I could ask you the opposite question or the inverse question, which is, if I gave you this sequence, could you write down in sequence notation? So we're going to try that now with a few different sequences. So we'll do 3 of these. So write in sequence notation. And you don't have to start them at 1. We're going to start them whatever is basically easiest to think about. So first sequence, all right, this should take you back to middle school or whenever you looked at patterns, also known as sequences. What is happening if I go from one term to the next term?
Minus 2,
minus 2, minus 2, minus 2, minus 2. So this is what we call an additive pattern. So we're going to decrease by 2 every time I go up by 1 for my n. Let's think about way back to what this relates to. So when n is 0, I get 3. So if I call this n equals 0 term, n equals 1, I absolutely can't write. I can't fit these in there. So if I go over 1, I go down 2. That's what I want you to see. When n goes over 1, my sequence value drops by 2. So this is what we call a slope. So when I go down over 1, I go down 2. If I go over another 1, I go down 2 more. So if I plotted these out, it would form a line. In the good old days, what's the equation of this line? So it's going to be mx plus b form, the way I wrote it out. What is m? Yep. And what is our slope in this particular line?
Negative 2.
So we're going over 1, down 2. What is our b, our y-intercept?
3.
All right. Very good. So good trip back to algebra 1 right there. So over here, it's the exact same thing happening. The only difference is you're going to use n instead of x. So this is going to look like negative 2n. What that does, every time n goes up by 1, our value is going to decrease by 2. So it's a little strange when you see it written out. But if you just think back to lines, when I go over 1, I want to go down 2. And then I'll go plus 3. If I do 2n plus 3, what should n be in this case, the way I wrote it down, to get the first term, n better start at 0. Now we have to figure out what n value gets me negative 5. So if you have some good intuition and you can count on your fingers, you can probably figure out what n value I need to finish with. Let's say that we don't want to use intuition. Let's use algebra instead. So we're trying to find the final n value. So what I'm going to do is set my term equal to negative 5. So solve for n right now. Tell me the n value that gets me negative 5. Should be an easy algebra problem. So any algebra questions on getting to 4? So this should seem a little strange. We got 5 terms, but we stopped at 4. When you count normally, what number do you usually start with?
1.
What number do we start with?
0.
So we got 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So there's really 5 terms total. So unfortunately, the way these work, if you do 4 minus 0 gives you 4, but there's really an extra term because we're starting on the 0 term, and we're ending on the 4 term. So if you subtract these two, there's really one more term hiding in there. So you want to be a little careful with that. You can use your fingers. You just start, before I wrote down the 4, you say the first term is 0. So I'm looking at the 3 right now. So this will be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. So if I start at 0, I can just count like this. It's different if I have 120 terms. I probably don't want to count that out. Then I want to use algebra to get the last term. If you only have a few terms, you can just count them out. All right, so that's how we handle an additive pattern. So I'll write the general additive form. So what it'll look like, I don't want to use M. All my favorite letters are in use. Let's go BN plus, oh, we usually use B for that letter. Let's go CN plus B. I don't want to use M because we're using M as our last, our final value. All right, so this is the additive form. And this means we're going to add C each time we move over. So this is when we add C to the previous term, we get the next one, which is exactly what we did here. You told me add negative 2 or subtract 2. So that's why this is negative 2n. So that's what that form looks like. All right, so that's additive pattern. Next sequence we're going to look at, we'll start out in a sort of a similar way. Oh, actually, cancel that. I'm going to re-index. All right, let's talk about re-indexing. Now, what if I told you that we had to start the sequence at 1, n equals 1 instead of 0? So what I changed is instead of starting n at 0, we're starting it at 1. So we're going to boost up our starting value by 1. So what we have to do is compensate. There's a few ways to compensate for this. I could compensate by, instead of writing n, decrease n by 1. So I can write it as negative 2 times n minus 1 plus 3. What would my final value be? Would it be 3 or 5? So I'm basically shifting n up 1, so I need to shift the n value up 1 also. So I need to stop at 5 now. And if we just distribute right here, we have negative 2n plus 2 plus 3. Uh-oh, that's not good. Yeah, plus 5. You can always check your work just by plugging in the first couple n values and see what you get. So if I plug in n as 1, we have negative 2 plus 5 is our first term. Our second term, when n is 2, I get negative 4 plus 5. My third term, when n is 3, that's negative 6 plus 5. And just reduce these down, we got negative positive 3, 1, negative 1, etc. So this should work out right here. So you can change your index value, you can increase it by 1 or 2, but you have to compensate when you do that. So we'll do a few more examples of re-indexing, but it's good to start that idea early. So our next sequence, negative 3, 1, negative 1 third, 1 ninth, negative 127th, 181st. Let's keep going. Negative 1 over 2. Is it 243? I think that's what comes next. Yep. All right. What pattern is happening here? What are we doing with negative 1/3? So this is a multiplicative pattern. So you can try additive. If I tried additive, what would I add to negative 3 to get 1? Plus 4. So let's look at that pattern. If we go forward, does plus 4 take me to negative 1/3? Nope. It really only takes 3 terms to know if you're additive or multiplicative. 3 turns out to be the magic number with patterns, usually, because you need 2 to establish something and then your third one to confirm it. So what we're going to do is multiply right here. So if I multiply by negative 1/3, does that hold up on the next term? So 1 times negative 1/3 is negative 1/3, so that's good. What about next? Is negative 1/3 multiplying get us here? Yep, and it should take us all the way over. So we're going to multiply by negative 1/3. So the multiplicative pattern So I'll multiply by r each time. So in our case, r was negative 1/3, but the multiplicative pattern is going to look like r to the n plus b. Now, sometimes you could see a c in front of this. All right, so here's the multiplicative pattern. If you want to think about it in the easiest way, you could just think about it as basically just r to the n. So let's go ahead and start writing this down. So this should be negative 1/3 to the n. And let's start n at 0. What term would I get for my first term if this was my actual sequence right here? What would my first term be? So they're not quite equal yet. What would my first term actually be out of here? What's negative 1/3 to the 0? 1. My next term would be negative 1/3 to the first. So it'd be, rookie mistake. 1, negative 1/3. All right, that's not quite what we got. The problem is our sequence starts at negative 3. So if I use this, I would be creating the series starting 1 too far over. So there's a few ways to fix this. What if I fix this with changing my index? What n value should I start at so that I actually get my first term as negative 3? What term would I have if I started n at 1? What would my first term be now? That would give me this sequence right there. That moved the wrong direction. That's worse. What n value would move me to where I want to start?
Negative 1.
So we're going to go the other direction. So we're going to go negative 1. So we'll start at negative 1. And that will give me, so let's just check our first few terms here. So that gives us negative 1/3 to the negative 1. Negative 1/3 to the 0 would be the next term, et cetera, et cetera. What does a negative power do? I know you have to go way back to precalculus. So yeah, reciprocates, flips your fraction over. So that gives us negative 3, comma, everything to the 0 power. Well, almost everything to the 0 power is 1. So there we go. Our first two terms are correct now. So we fixed it by re-indexing. So these are now equal, so I'll just put the regular equal sign in there. All right, so we fixed this problem by reindexing here. What I also need to know is what is my final value right here? So we can count on our fingers, or we can not be silly and write numbers here. So we said negative 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I can count up like that. So we're going to put 5 up here, the way it's written now. How could I get 5 using algebra? What equation would I set up? Yep, so we just set our, whatever our term is, equal to the last one, and then what n value makes them the same. So, just looking, n better be odd or we're in trouble. If n's even, you're going to get a positive number. So n better be odd. 243, oh man, that's 3 to a power. So let's say you're bad at powers. So 3 to the first is 3. 3 squared is 9, 3 cubed, 27, 3 to the 4th, let's write that as 3 squared squared, so that's 9 squared, 81. 3 to the 5th power, we can write it as 3 to the 4th times 3, 81 times 3, 243. So 3 to the 5th is 243. So I could distribute my n right here. So here's where you can really clearly see n better be odd, or else there's no way this is going to be equal, and n equals 5 in this case. All right, so that is algebraically how to find that 5 at the end. So any questions about writing this out, about the n values? All right, I don't like my sequences to start at negative n values, so I want you to reindex this starting at 0. So the two things you need are what goes on the inside, and then what is our final n value. So we're shifting n up by 1. So the final n value should be pretty easy to think about. Just remember, you're shifting n up by 1. So I'll give you a minute to, you can guess and check if you want to. That's a good way to do things generally. Just make sure you do the checking part, not just the guessing part. So if you shift n up by 1, you're going to stop at 6 instead of 5. So just think, instead of going negative 1 to 5, you're shifting them up, so you go from 0 to 6. And when you compensate for that, so instead of starting at negative 1, you're starting at 0, you have to make sure your initial exponent is still negative 1. So if I start at 0, I better go n minus 1. So when n is 0, my initial exponent is negative 1. All right, any questions on this reindexing here? You can always do algebra. So let's do a tiny bit of algebra. There should be some pretty easy algebra right here. So I didn't change the index. All I did was wrote n minus 1. And actually, instead of multiplying, let's write it. You can write it like this, too. Either a negative first power is a product or a reciprocal. And now fractions of fractions, try to avoid those. So I'm going to multiply by the reciprocal of the denominator. So we have negative 3 is a reciprocal of negative 1/3. So I can write it like this. I could reindex again if I needed to. But what you should be able to do is change these around a little bit. Either do a little algebra or a little reindexing. All right, so that's a multiplicative pattern. Oh, that's a lot of writing. Looks like a crazy person's manifesto. All right, one tricky thing to remember. Multiplicative pattern, it looks exponential. And additive pattern looks multiplicative. So it's a little tricky. Additive looks like you're multiplying. And multiplicative pattern looks like you're taking exponents or exponentiating, if that's a verb. So they look a little different. So your intuition might be off a little bit until you get some more practice. So we're going to look at a few more patterns now that are not additive or multiplicative. So the third that we're going to look at. So let's try additive. What would I add to go from 0 to 1? Plus 1. What do I add? And if I add plus 1, does that take me from 1 to 4? Nope, definitely not. So remember, you only need to look at three terms in a row to decide if you're additive or multiplicative or not. So that's not additive. Let's try multiplicative. What's wrong with multiplicative and just the first? What's anything times? Yeah, if you got 0, anything times 0 is 0. So multiplicative breaks down just right across the first two terms. So multiplicative is out. So take a minute and think about what pattern do you see happening here. The 0 might be throwing you off, so you could ignore that for a minute and just think about these numbers here. They should be somewhat familiar. What do all those properties have? Or what property do these numbers have? Could you take the square roots of those numbers?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. So, can you take the square root of 0?
Sure.
So these are what we call perfect squares. What's 0 squared?
0.
What's 1 squared? 1, 2 squared, 3 squared, 4 squared. So this is a progression of squares, or a square pattern. You could have progression of cubes. That would look a little different. That would go 0, 1, 8, 27, and whatever comes next, 64, something like that. So this would be a progression of squares. We can write this down pretty easily. It's just n squared. So it's a little strange. It looks like it's a polynomial. And write your initial and final values out, your starting n value and your last n value. So you should go 0 to 4. And you can always do that trick where you do your last value minus your initial value, and you'll have one more term hiding in there than that number. So this 4 minus 0 is 4, but there's really 5 terms. So this trick works all the time. You can subtract your beginning and ending values, and that's one less than the number of terms you have. So the next pattern we're going to look at will be new for most of you. It's called factorials. So we'll start with the definition. So we need n to be a positive integer. So we'll write n is in z, which is the integers. If I want positive ones, I'll just write z plus. So that means none of the negatives. And I'll write down the first few factorials. Oh. 0 factorial is 1, 1 factorial is 1, 2 factorial is 2, 3 factorial is 6, 4 factorial is 24. The definition of n factorial is n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 all the way down until you get to 1. So it's all the integers n and smaller multiply together. Why would it be a really bad move to throw in 0? What would every factorial be if I went down to 0? Every factorial would be 0. That's pretty boring. So that's why we don't go to 0. We stop at 1, or else all of them would be 0. It wouldn't be a very useful tool to use. All right, so all we do, 0 factorial is a little different. Doesn't fit the pattern. But it's just defined to be 1. It doesn't fit in this pattern here, but we just say that it's 1. 1 factorial is just 1. 2 factorial is really 2 times 1, which is 2. 3 factorial is 3 times 2 times 1, which is 6. 4 factorial, 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. Now, after some point, it becomes a little silly to write 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. What I'm going to do is write it as 4 times 3 factorial. So I already computed 3 factorial. So I'm just going to write this as 4 times the 3 factorial, which is 4 times 6, and that's 24. So we'll go to 5 factorial next. The best way to do the bigger factorials, just write it as 5 times the next smaller factorial. I could write it as 5 times 4, 3, 2, 1, but it's way faster to write it as 5 times 4 factorial, like this, which is, of course, 5 times 24, which is 120. Take a minute and compute 6 factorial and 7 factorial. No shame in doing long multiplication if you need to. So any questions on these 6 and 7 factorials? One thing you should notice, these factorials get really big quickly. So if I had 8 factorial, it would be a big number. 9 factorial, even bigger. So these factorials get big really quickly. So we're going to do a tiny bit more algebra on factorials. So n factorial, you can of course write as n times n minus 1 factorial. So you can factor out an n. You can also factor out the first two numbers. So you can write it as n times the next smaller integer times the factorial, the remaining factorial. You can keep going if you want to. You factor out 3. So you're just left with n minus 3 factorial. So I want you to find 12 factorial divided by 10 factorial. And the way to do it is factor out the first two numbers. So we got 12 times 11 times 10 factorial. What can I do algebraically here?
Cancel.
So we have three products in the numerator, and so I'm going to cancel the last product with a denominator right here. So all we have is 12 times 11, and that is 121 maybe. No. Uh-oh. Yes. 130 something? 132? All right. So there is one factorial right there. So last problem. So figure out this factorial right here. And I'll give you a hint, it's going to be a fraction, less than 1. So denominator is way bigger than the numerator. So it's going to be a pretty small number. So it's similar process, except now the denominator has got way more factors. So any questions on 1 over 720? All right, so we'll do some really crazy algebra tomorrow and get into some summations, which is where you add up the terms of a sequence.